About Infertility 101, more of an overview of infertility and the infertility treatment world. So please join me in welcoming him.
All right, guys, thanks a lot. This is very, very, very informal. So please stop me, interrupt me, raise your hand, holler. We're gonna cover, I think, quite a bit of ground. In moderate detail. So if you want to stop and spend more time on something like endometriosis or sperm, whatever, but if you're talking about, you know, something that is years and years to learn, we're going to cover a lot of information. So very simple. And all of my professors, all of my life, tried to take really complex things and keep them complex. I think it takes skill to take complex things and try to keep them simple. So I try to distill these things down. Infertility, probably everybody knows this, but it's 1 year of trying. There are some exceptions. If you're over 35, do not wait, do not pass go, do not collect $100. Get to someone like me. All my OBGYN friends say, hey, Ryan, when do we send people to you? They call me all from all over the country. And I said, one of the things I tell them is that lady is over 35. Just send her right on, you know, because time is of the essence because of the importance of egg health. And we'll cover all that. If you're not having regular periods, what does that mean? Anybody know? No. What does that mean fundamentally?
Not ovulating.
Who said that? Good job. And I see patients with this all the time, and even doctors and OBGYNs. It's that simple. The young ladies, if you're not having regular periods, you're not ovulating. If you're having regular periods, you are ovulating. You do not need to spend money unless you just like to waste it on day 21 progesterones. You do not need to do LH kits necessarily unless you just want to know. You are ovulating. It's that simple. Because we won't go into the physiology, but it just means you're ovulating. Obviously, if you've had a vasectomy, if you have real bad fibroids, endometriosis, recurrent pregnancy loss, get to us sooner. And I think there's a lot of stigma or kind of, if you will, negativism or negative thoughts, if you will, or concern. People don't want to come see me because they're afraid of what we're going to tell them. And I guess it depends a lot on who you see and what they're, in terms of physicians and what their approach is. But I've seen many couples in my career who I said, listen, you guys, you're here a little bit early. We just need a little more patience. We need a nice dinner, some bottles of wine, some time together. So if I see patients and they don't need to be in my office, you know, what I usually will do, it depends on the situation, but we can check some egg health, that's good. Make sure the sperm is there. And if everything looks good, I'm gonna say, hey, go home and keep trying for another 6 months. You know, and I've actually been fired by patients for that. I took care of a very young lady when I was in Overland Park earlier, and it had been 5 or 6 months. None of this. No vasectomy, regular periods. And this young lady, she was a very spirited young lady, and she wanted to do IVF. And I think it was her friend. And I said, you don't need IVF. You don't even have infertility yet. Why do you need IVF? Why do you want to spend all this money? And we checked the gentleman's sperm, and it was good, and the egg health and the tubes, everything was fine. We just needed time. So I said, why don't you guys go home and try some more? It's a lot more fun. It's a lot cheaper. And she went and did IVF in New York, and she got pregnant. Who's surprised by that? Not me. She didn't need IVF in the first place. That's like giving chemotherapy to somebody who has cancer and celebrating you cured them, or somebody who doesn't have cancer. You know, so if you don't need it, someone like me, we're going to tell you, hey, go home and try some more. What are the general causes of infertility? There's kind of three big groups. About 40% of the time it's male, about 40% of the time it's female, and about 20% it's unexplained. And I'll talk a little bit about each of those. But I just want to point out probably one of the cheapest, best tests in infertility medicine is the semen analysis. It's, you know, relatively inexpensive. The guys might disagree with me, but it's relatively painless. It's not invasive. And you're going to get 40% of the pie chart right there. And there are kind of two passions I have. I have many passions, but one is egg health, and we'll talk about that. But getting the OBGYNs in the community, to get this semen analysis on the husbands is really hard. And we talk and we talk and we talk. And I see patients every year, every month, who have 6 clomid, 8 clomid cycles, shouldn't be doing that many anyway, and we'll get into that, why that is, and there's no semen analysis. Yes?
I have a question about that.
Yeah.
So how many, and this might be a silly question, but how many semen analysis are recommended? Like if you have one and there's no issues and it's been...
Awesome question. We're gonna cover that. The answer is 1 to 2. Here's my philosophy. If you have a normal semen analysis, I only check one. If it's, you know, as I tell the guys, you know, I sign it, autograph it, put it on the wall, and they have a bad day, they're like, yeah, this rocks. You know, I tell them, this is rock star sperm, this is really good, keep this, you know? And the guys are like, fist bump with me, you know? All right? So I don't repeat that because I think that's fine. If I have like minor abnormality, we're going to talk about this, a minor abnormality in sperm, like normal motility is, say, anything above 40%, say the gentleman's 39%. I'm not repeating that. You know, that looks good. But if I have a severely abnormal semen analysis, or I have no sperm on semen analysis, or we're making a major decision, we're deciding, do we want to do IUI or do we want to do IVF? That's a major call. I'm getting 2 semen analyses, and that's a standard of care. And Dr. Nangia was talking about that. Isn't he great? He's a good friend of mine. But if you can, I discourage community labs. And what he means by that, since I'm being videoed over here, I'll put it this way, which is fine, by the way. Try to find a lab that does this a lot. You know, so what an infertility clinic, you know, somebody who does these all the time. And that's really important. I have a patient I took care of in Denver, ultimately ended up doing IVF with me. Her husband, he was like Hurt Locker guy. He disarmed bombs in the military, and he was always down in Arizona. And we had to end up, there was some sperm stuff going on, and we had to get a semen analysis, and it was like the weirdest semen analysis ever. And like Dr. Nagy was saying, like the rep, it just didn't, and I'm talking to him, I'm like, you know, I don't know what to think of, but he's up working down there. We can't get him back to Denver to get the semen analysis. And, you know, his wife was a very polite lady, and I'm like, I don't know what to make of this semen analysis. It's kind of weird. And she surprised me. I'm going to use some colorful language. She said, you know, Dr. Reed, my husband said that hospital was a total shit show. You know. So if you can find a clinic, you know, that does this for a living, that's a good thing. You're going to get better results. So 2, typically, if you're making a major decision, is your answer. So if you're a fertility doctor, so if you come to me and you have one, then, and it's normal, it depends on the duration. I probably wouldn't repeat it if it's relatively recent. But if it's pretty abnormal, I'm going to repeat it. And like everything else, how you implement the semen and how you do the test matters. So sometimes we repeat them and we actually get normal results too. So it goes both directions. All right, so when you look at the lady, how does this work? About 40% of it's tubal or pelvic, 40% ovarian, some unexplained, which in my opinion isn't really unexplained, and I'll get into that in a little bit. And then some other stuff that falls into a catch-all category. So when we're talking about tubal disease, we're really just talking about fallopian tubes, okay? And sperm problems, ovulatory and ovarian dysfunction, we kind of already covered all you need to know there. If you're having regular periods, you're ovulating. Endometriosis, we'll talk about that. Fibroids, occasionally, another story that I probably should, you know, as I'm talking to you guys out there, like there's another great story, 2 great stories, and these are fun ones, and you can go to my website, Tessa, because Tessa was Quintner, one of my patients, and I'm using her name, her real name, because the news came and did a story on her, and so everyone knows it's on my website. But she came to me because she had irregular cycles. She had PCOS. When we did her genetic testing, we found out that she had premutations for Fragile X, which is the number one cause of inherited mental retardation in the United States. So ultimately, a patient who came to me because she doesn't have regular menstrual cycles, who ended up doing IVF, not because PCOS, but because we needed to genetically screen her embryos and put back the ones that were lowest risk. So those are really fun, but pretty uncommon. Aging and egg health, we'll talk about that. Endocrine disorders and unexplained. So, go ahead.
it may be dumb, but with any kind of birth control, do infertility too? Like, I know they say the shot is known to cause many problems too.
So, is the question, does birth control cause infertility? The answer is no, but it doesn't prevent infertility either. And so, I've got some charts on, or graphs on that, but women start with about 6 million eggs, and by the time they get to menopause, they have about 1,000. And everybody, you know, if you start your period at 12 or 13, you have 11 to 13 menstrual cycles a year, average age of menopause is 51. Everybody in this room can do the math. That's like 600 eggs, right? But how do you get from 6 million to 1,000 when only 600 are lost in ovulation? What really is, you're losing eggs through what we call apoptosis. They're going through what's called programmed cell death. And so women who have aging issues, when I say aging, I mean egg health issues, they're just, either two things are happening. Well, one of three things. One, they started with fewer eggs. Two, they're losing more eggs per month than normal. Or three, we don't know. Which the third, you know, aspects of that process that we don't know. But to build on your question, the question I always get from residents and medical students before I just tell them what I told you is, they say, so can I stop ovarian aging? Can I help my egg health of my patients by putting them on birth control pills? The answer is no, because it's 600 is a rounding error out of millions. Does that make sense? And the same question comes up, and people say, but Dr. Riggs, hopefully you're going to take all these eggs out of me. Is that going to put me in the menopause? 15 eggs out of millions, the answer is no. It's a small and insignificant number. Does that make sense? All right. So I made this slide years ago. I still use it. It drives all the basic testing that we do. And I like to keep it simple. Look, we need to check out the eggs. Two parts to that. One, we're going to ask the lady if she's having regular periods. That costs nothing. Two, I'm going to ask how old you are. Or you already told me, basically. That's also relatively inexpensive. We check the eggs also with an ultrasound and getting labs, and I'm going to talk about that. We talked about the semen analysis already. This is supposed to be fertilization. Unfortunately, there's no test for fertilization, unless you've had a baby already. If you say, I have a 4-year-old and now I can't conceive, we call that secondary infertility, right? Then obviously you've had fertilization. And this is, by the way, remember when I said I don't really believe in unexplained infertility? That's what this is. There are problems with fertilization. We just can't tell you what they are yet because we can't test for it. Does that make sense? All right? Think about it. It's a lock and key system. It's way more complicated than that because there are people who spend their whole life just studying right here, this little sperm activating this egg and getting in there. But you could imagine scenarios where maybe the sperm doesn't have the appropriate key to get into the egg, right? It could exist. We just can't prove that to you. Or vice versa, egg. Yes?
Can you have regular periods but not be ovulating?
No.
So if you're having a period, then you are ovulating.
Correct. It's physiologically impossible. If they're regular periods, and they're normal, I always ask patients, is it like a normal period for you? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I don't mean like you spotted and that was really weird and that's not a period.
No.
You know what I mean? If you had a regular period that's normal for you, and it's coming roughly every month. All right, let me ask another question. This is a little harder. What's the cycle interval for a normal menstrual period? Throw some numbers out there.
26 to...
28, 26? 30. All right. Normal menstrual, every 25 to 35 days. You ladies, you're not robots. It's okay if it was 28 days, and the next month it was 30 days, and the next month it's cool. You're good. But if you're going 3 months without a period, that's not normal. Everybody knows that. So just keep in mind, that's really important. And I think due to some really bad old doctors, the whole birth control thing is made up and artificial anyway. We could, 28 days was really came from a rant, basically an artificial number that the people who invented birth control pills in the 60s picked out. They could have made it every 30 days. They could have made it every 34 days. They just picked every 28 days. Yes?
What determines how many follicles you release every month?
I mean, good question.
Like with fertility drugs, Clomid or Follistim or whatever.
So it's
sometimes there's few and sometimes there's more.
Part of it we don't understand. Part of it's age and egg health. Part of it's the dose of the medication. That's a great question. That's a fellow level question. And I'll touch on that a little bit. So there's, I've got a kind of chalkboard here. So imagine it like this. So here are your eggs, and these are resting eggs. All right, and they're just waiting to be, we use the word in the medical field, I'm getting nerdy on you, recruited to be picked up by the FSH, by the brain, right? So you have BR. All right, here's the brain. And the brain, as everyone knows, is making this FSH. This is an egg recruiting hormone. You know, we test it. And what the FSH is coming down here, and this is the ovary now, and it's under normal circumstances, one of these will sort of be the best. And it, meaning it has, essentially, it's the most fit, survival of the fittest. So it gets picked up by this FSH, and it moves here into the recruitable area and starts to grow. Now, to your point, when you're using medications, you're using, and like in, and now we're in IVF, right? We're supposed to be in fertility 101. But when you're using FSH, that's what gonal-F, follistim, those kinds of meds is, you're using high doses of medication to drop this bar down, and you recruit multiple eggs. Does that make sense? It also explains to you why, and I'm way off topic, although pregnancy rates as women age are older, as women's age and get older decline, twins increase. Why is that? Because as women age, their FSH goes up. That's what happens. That's part of ovarian aging. So yes, they have fewer overall good eggs, but when they recruit with the higher FSH and they have higher twin rates. Does that kind of make sense? So I hope I answered your question a little bit. But I would also say down here, we don't understand a lot of what's going on in the ovary at the almost molecular level, because how can we study that? We can't study it in human ladies. The only way we could really study this is cut your ovaries out, slice it up, and, you know, but even that wouldn't give us this answer, right? So we study it in gorillas, basically, and obviously gorillas are very different than humans, so we don't know a lot about that. All right, and then we got to check out the uterus, fallopian tubes. If everything goes well, we get a bambino. All right. Everybody, okay, another question. And thank you for answering, by the way. Where does fertilization take place? Where do the egg and sperm meet?
Fallopian tube.
Good job. You guys are better than the medical students. Right, that's exactly right. And that should make sense to you, because that's how we get ectopic pregnancies, right? Pregnancies in the fallopian tube is not where we want. But if fertilization was to take place there, that's where it happens, and that's exactly right. So if you have things that impact the fallopian tubes, then that's going to cause a problem. And I don't just mean, people think, oh, my fallopian tube's blocked, and that's not good. I agree that's a problem. But what if the fallopian tube, you know, your fallopian tube is supposed to kind of run along like that, right? But what if you have some scar tissue, like we're showing you here. And instead of running along like that, your fallopian tube is kinked, right? That's not normal either. And so one way you see problems is the tube is blocked. The other way is you have scar tissue that disturbs the anatomy. Or take a look here. You see these little, like right here. They're like little finger-like projections. Those are supposed to pick up the egg. The egg's coming out of the ovary. If those aren't normal and those aren't functional, it's not going to work. There's no on-ramp for the egg to get into the fallopian tube. So endometriosis, gonorrhea, chlamydia, prior surgery. Here's another one that gets people that they don't think about, ruptured appendicitis. Because sitting right up over here on the right side, you know what's over there? The appendix. The appendix gets big. It's going to drip some nice pus down here. All right? And that's going to infect and swirl around in there, and that could cause some of the worst scar tissue you can ever see on the fallopian tubes. So if I see my patients, they say they have appendicitis, I always want to know, how'd that go? Was that, did it rupture? I have a patient right now that I'm getting ready to do IVF on, and she did have a ruptured appendicitis in a very significant hospital course, and this is, you know, that can cause problems. All right.
Does that only happen if the appendix ruptures?
For the most part, yes. I mean, if you just developed appendicitis, general surgery puts it in, pulls it out, you're fine. I wouldn't worry too much. But if your story is my appendix ruptured, I had a drain coming out of my skin for a week, and I had 8 days of IV antibiotics in the hospital, you were really infected and that bothers me, you know, in terms of what your fallopian tubes are going to be like. But if you just, don't get me wrong, if you just had appendicitis, you went in, you know, doctor got it out, I don't think, I think you're fine. Does that make sense? All right. Now, we talked about ovulation. This is what a normal ovary looks like. This is what a less normal ovary looks like. What you're really seeing here is all of the eggs, for lack of a better term, are just trapped. And they're not coming out. And when the eggs don't come out, you don't get regular periods. So we've talked about that. Let's talk about egg health. I think this is how a lot of patients feel, and I'm with them on that. You know, we're going to talk about basically the eggs now. And we, 1 in 6 couples have trouble conceiving. I can't stress enough that you folks are not alone. And I just want to point out in this chart, this is like a basically an academic chart, but I think it is so educational. What this is telling you is that at age 31, 50% of women have some subfertility. All right? So it's so common. I'm biased, but, you know, I'd like to start checking AMHs on everybody when they're 25. I just would. And I have a big beef with my OBGYN friends. Every time you ladies go into the office, and I know I got trained by the same people, they're asking you what you want to do for birth control pill or birth control, right? That's great. But if you're 30 or 35 and you don't have any children yet, it might be nice to ask you, hey, do you want to have any kids? Have you thought about that process? And if you're like, yeah, well, whatever, we're waiting, let's check an AMH on you. You know, because what I hear all day, every day is, I wish somebody would have told me. So it's pretty common. At 41, half of women are sterile, which is a nice way of saying, or a mean way of saying, you can't have children, right? The other thing that's important here is you get, see the cycle irregularity in menopause? What I want to point out is that happens after. So this is a silent process. For the most part, it's like hypertension or high blood pressure. You don't know that you're becoming infertile, right? Until maybe you get hot flushes, or maybe your periods get a little wacky, but by that time, you're already past sterility. So we need to be aggressive, we need to be proactive about checking these things. All right, so basically, kind of a little mental break. I like to have some children someday, but only after I've established a career. Yes?
Okay, on that last chart, you had cycle irregularity post-menopause, but if your cycle irregularity is in your early ages, does that mean you're
close? No, it does not. And that's why you need a doctor to help you tease through this. Okay. Because PCOS ladies, come on in, please have a seat. PCOS ladies have irregular menstrual cycles, and they're not in menopause. And so there are usually some other signs. I mentioned vaginal dryness, hot flushes, things like that. But, you know, the point is get checked out. Does that make sense? Get that, and we'll talk about anti-Müllerian. Get that AMH, get that FSH, and you'll get your answer pretty quickly at that point. That makes sense? All right. But think big picture of what's really happening. A century ago, or thereabouts, half of all women died in childbirth. So there weren't a lot of ladies trying to have babies in their late 30s and early 40s. So technology and medicine and education has changed tremendously in 100 years. There are more women in medical school by far than men. That is a fact. So women are out there pursuing their dreams, pursuing their education, and they're also putting off having children. And from kind of a survival or reproductive perspective, if you're the human species and you want to survive, and half of all women die in childbirth, when do the best eggs come out? When you're in your late, basically when you're a teenager, which we don't want that. We don't like teen pregnancies in this day, right? But that's the system. So technology and science has the situation where basically women are set up and couples, for the most part, in large part, to pursue children in their 20s and 30s and even 40s, and I'll show you that data. But the biology, it's still, you know, biological change happens across millions of years. So that's why, I guess, people like me have a job. And so what you're seeing here is just, this is just census data. Look, so young women are not having as many babies. We think that's a good thing. That's what we worked really hard for. But look at this number. Doesn't this blow? This blows me away. This is old data. It's like 2006. 150% increase in women in their 45 to 49 range. Six. Look at this. Just blowing up with ladies wanting to have babies. And again, perfect, totally appropriate. Everything that, none of this is a surprise. So what we have, what's happening is women want to have children. And this is when they're at their greatest risk for having egg health problems. Now don't look at the blacks over here. This is what I was touching on. Here's 26 weeks in utero. I'm not saying 26 weeks old. I mean 26 weeks before you ladies were born. So you're sleeping, you're in the uterus, maximum number of eggs. Look what happens to the eggs by the time you're born. That's how many eggs you lose. And then you're like, well, this is, then here is from birth to puberty. So you're not really fertile until you start in puberty, right? I mean, that's what that is kind of happening there. And that looks, I'm like, wow, that's a pretty big drop too, right? So look how many eggs are, you're down here well under a million from about 4 million. And you're 12. And this is normal. This is not abnormal. So this chart really says it all. And then you say, well, look, this is pretty, that's not bad. You're not losing many eggs, right? So look what happens when you blow this up. From 18 to 48, look what happens to egg. You go from 100,000 by the time you're in menopause to about 1,000. And again, these eggs are not lost through ovulation. They're just being lost through what we call apoptosis. They basically disintegrate, for lack of a better medical term. Does that make sense? Now, your curve could be different. If you were born with outstanding genetics, you might be shifted a little bit this way. Does that make sense? But if you are at risk for poor egg health, you could be shifted this way. And maybe at 30, you have 1,000 eggs and you're in menopause. That could happen. That's a true condition. We call that, when women hit menopause under 40, we call that premature ovarian insufficiency. We used to call it premature ovarian failure, but you can't say a failure anymore with anything because it's not politically correct. We change it to premature ovarian insufficiency. So this really is what we're up against here, folks. And it's more problematic than that because, again, all I want you to look at is the number of eggs are declining, but the number of abnormal eggs remaining is increasing. So as women are aging, the number of eggs is decreasing. And the ones that are left are not the best ones. Because the best ones came out when you ladies were 18, 19, 20, because Mother Nature thinks you're going to pass away, half of you with childbirth, but that's not the case anymore because we have modern medicine and science and biology. All right? Just a quick slide. So this is by birth rates. This is old. It's 2010 data. This is the whole country. And all I really want to show you is pregnancy rates decline with age. And everybody gets that in IVF cycles. But look, this chart is donor egg. It doesn't go down. It's all about the eggs, gentlemen and ladies. So the point is, if your uterus is 45 or 50, your pregnancy rate is still the same as if your uterus is 20, as long as that egg is genetically normal and comes from a younger person. So there are some help. I mean, I get a little bit worried about ladies. I don't put embryos back in ladies over 52 because of concerns with, and we make them do some other things to make sure they're healthy, like check their heart, et cetera, et cetera. At the same time, I had a patient in Denver. She was 53 or 54, and this lady ran marathons, and I have no doubt that she's going to have just an awesome, uneventful pregnancy. But we want to make sure these folks are healthy in terms of their blood pressure and their heart. But from the perspective of the uterus doesn't really age. And sperm really doesn't age either. All you got to know, Mick Jagger has children. Larry King, that guy's like a mummy. He has children, okay? So I think sperm does age. I think it's true, but not on the scale that eggs change. Does that make sense? Yes.
So then is it in women's best interest to bank eggs?
Yes, ma'am. Another pet peeve of mine. Freezing eggs is really important. So to build on that, if you're a 30-year-old lady, most ladies in here, I think, have partners. But if you're a 30-year-old or a 32-year-old, if you ladies or gentlemen, you have a friend and she's 34, she hasn't met Mr. Wright and all men are dogs and she just can't meet Mr. Wright, have her go get her AMH checked because she may want to freeze her eggs. And then when she meets Mr. Wright, if she meets Mr. Wright, we can thaw those eggs and incubate them and make babies. If she meets Mr. Wright and her egg health is fine and she has a baby, fine. But she has that as a backup plan. So yes, that is, and eggs don't age, and embryos don't age when they're frozen. They're good for thousands of years. Yes?
Do you know if there's any testing going on of how to stop the aging or help?
We're trying. It's very, yeah, I mean, people, and we can talk a little bit about egg aging and acai and CoQ10 and DHEA and some of those adjuncts. That's I call that the holy grail in my field. I mean, if you guys have any ideas, let me know. Because if we can, I can retire, I will win the Nobel Prize, I will split it with you, everything, but, you know, it would be awesome. But we haven't figured that one out. And, yes?
Would you recommend, that you're working with this
sure.
stuff, but do you recommend any natural, acupuncture, chiropractic stuff?
I think acupuncture's great. That's a controversial issue and very practice by practice. My view on the acupuncture piece is that there have been studies that have shown that acupuncture has helped. There have been studies that have shown acupuncture doesn't help. And there was actually one decent study that showed that acupuncture hurt. And you're like, wow, but think about what, be a scientist if you're not, if you believe that an intervention has the potential to help, shouldn't you also believe it has the potential to hurt, right? Think, that makes sense, right? And the best study, the part of the problem with acupuncture is how do you do a placebo group? Because people know if you stab them with a needle or not. Do you see what I'm saying? So there was one study they did, used a fake needle, and then I'm not an expert, there's like, saying do acupuncture, the acupuncture people, if there are, there's a lot of different ways to do acupuncture. And there's stuff I'm not the acupuncture person. So, you know, if you're like, well, that acupuncture study didn't help people, right? But the acupuncture people can say, yeah, but they didn't do the right kind of acupuncture. And then you're over my pay grade and I don't know what they're talking about. My belief, when I was in Denver, our practice was very, very pro-acupuncture. I will tell you that our internal data didn't show that it helped tremendously, if at all. They didn't do worse, they didn't really do better. So my belief on acupuncture, and I have no business interest in either, is I explain what I just explained to you guys, and I tell the patients, if you want to do it and you feel better when you're doing it, I think you should do it. But I can't, it's like supplements that are not FDA approved. I can't put my stamp of approval on it because the data is still inconclusive. Does that kind of make sense? At the same time, I'm not a cookie cutter. There's no one perfect way to do everything, and it's something I definitely would potentially recommend trying in folks from time to time based on their individual circumstances. Okay? All right. Egg health we talked about. Most important is age. AMH is the second most important, and antral follicle count. FSH is definitely in a second tier assay at this point in my mind. Definitely relegated to being less accurate, but still useful in some applications. So, for example, if I'm trying to diagnose a patient with premature ovarian failure, the diagnostic criteria don't use AMH. That's not because AMH is a bad test. It's because the old gray hairs that live in the ivory towers haven't gotten around, to adding it to that testing process. And they will in about 10 years, but then we'll be 10 years ahead of that, so it won't be relevant. Genetics is huge. Lifestyle, smoking is bad for eggs. Just like what Dr. Nangia says, you have to take good care of yourself. I have to be candid, weight does matter. Extremes of weight in both directions, and there's pretty good data for that. I always tell my patients, even losing a little bit of weight, 5 pounds, 10 pounds, can make a huge difference. So that's egg health. What about the uterus? So basically, you can have problems inside the uterus, like a little polyp, or you can have fibroids. You can imagine that if an embryo comes out of the fallopian tube, right? Because fertilization took place. And it went here, where there's this big fibroid. It's not going to implant, right? Everybody, hello. One of the things that I do, I'll brag on our clinic for 1 minute, and is that we have a small camera, it's not as bad as it sounds, that we can put inside the uterus while you're awake and fill it with water. It takes about 5 minutes. It's about half as bad as an HSG. I'm sure some of you have had an HSG in here. It takes about 3 minutes. Here's the point. We find stuff all the time that doesn't get picked up on saline ultrasound, that doesn't get picked up on HSG. So I think that's really important if you're spending money, especially, not for everyone, but especially in an IVF cycle, putting a camera in there. Just yesterday, I have a patient. She's got something. I'm doing her scans, because I do all the scans, and she's got something in her uterus, and it looks a little weird. You know, but I don't know exactly what it is, but it doesn't look normal. And I put a camera in there, and she's got scar tissue. Totally not expecting that, you know. So when you look in with the camera at the uterus, it should just look like this, like an oval, right? There's a little circle for the fallopian tube. That's what you see, all right? And this person has stalactites. This is scar tissue, you know. So we caught that early, and I mean, of course she's upset, but at least we caught it before she did 5 IUIs or 3 IUIs or IVF, you know. And I think when I was in Denver, we had 3 hysteroscopes. I did 500 of these a year, and I think it's valuable. Basic evaluation: sperm. Ask about our basic assessment: sperm. Ask about ovulation. Do egg quality testing. Do the uterus, or follow up on the uterus. All right, so we're going to talk a little bit about the sperm. So when we measure sperm, you don't really think that we're counting like 100 million sperm, do you? I mean, no, of course not. So what we do, this is called a Mackler, M-A-C-K-L-E-R. You don't need to remember that. But basically, we count 10 squares, and we count how many sperm are in that. Then we count another 10 squares, and we write it down. They have to be within 10% of each other, and we then average them. If they're more than 10% apart, you have a problem, you need to recount. The problem is, sperm are swimming all, you know, you got these squares, and this guy started, and in 1 second, he's moving them. So you can see the problem, right? Especially on a really good energized sample, like maybe the guy had a copy. So that's how we do it. And that gives us that answer. And we count motility, and we do a percentage, and that's how you do that. And for the morphology, we put the sperm on a slide, and we make an old-fashioned stain. Remember that H&E thing from, like, that's what we do. And we look at it in a microscope. And there's computers that do this. It's called CASA computer. We don't have a computer because I still think old-fashioned, like getting somebody who, you know, looks at sperm all day, every day is better. Because the computer's, it's a computer. It doesn't think. You know, so if the gentleman has a lot of round cells, like see this little thing right here? That's a round cell. And that might be counted by a computer. And a human being would know that's not a sperm. All right, so morphology is always confusing. Morphology is the shape of the sperm. The shape of the sperm matters, guys, because it relates to the DNA of the sperm. And I think this is one time where I always say it's a little joke, it's not very good, but two heads are not better than one. We don't like the two-headed sperm. We don't like the platypus sperm. These are not real. I mean, they're real, but those are my names, not the science name. So if you have two tails, it's not good. The tail is the motor. The tail, remember, think about it. It's a little bit weird to think about, but the sperm gets dropped off when you're having sex in the vagina. Okay, and it has to swim all the way up through the cervix, all the way up through the uterus, and all the way out to the fallopian tube. So if the sperm can't move and it can't travel, then what's that?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, all right, cool. We'll be done. You're going to have a problem. A lot of variability in sperm. To extend on your question, you know, look at this guy. On the 82nd week, I don't know how they paid this guy to do this study, by the way. He has no sperm. But look up here. If you catch him on the 108th week, he's a rock star. He's got 120. So the answer is more semen analyses are better than one, but there's got to be a practical overlay there. All right, egg health. How do we measure it? We talked about hormones. So look at this ovary. It's a little hard to see, but you see it's all smashed down, and there's no little black follicles. These are eggs. So counting those eggs tells us about egg health. FSH, I kind of poo-pooed it, but it still has informational value. This is a famous study, like 9,000 women. If your FSH is above about 19, this is your live birth rate. Bang, good. That's called zero. So if your FSH is above that level, I'm not saying you can never get pregnant. It's really, 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 really hard, and you need to have a very frank discussion with your infertility specialist about, is that a judicious use of your funds and everything else that goes into it. And if you're older, look down here, if you're 43 plus, the pregnancy rate it hits a zero at about 11. So a high FSH or high abnormal egg health parameters at younger ages are better to have than at older ages. Make sense? All right. Can be abnormalities. These are, some women are born with congenital anomalies. Here's scar tissue, kind of what I was telling you about. This is bunny ears, called bicornuate. These are not normal. They tend to cause pregnancy loss. We find those with the camera. You find them on HSG. HSG, every lady's favorite test, tells us if the tubes are open. It is important. If you're at a center where the infertility specialist performs the HSG, in my opinion, I'm biased 100%. You're gonna have a better potential experience than if you go to a standalone imaging facility where you might get someone who doesn't do very many of these. And everybody in the room knows if you do a lot of something, hopefully you're better at it. All right, treatments depends on what's going on. All right, here's a pet peeve. I had this slide last night. I see people all the time in my clinic, and they've been to other clinics, and I say, you know, and many of them from out of state, so this is not meant to be commentary on anyone local. They've spent a lot of money, and they've done a fair amount of treatment, and I say, I know you're not the doctor, but what is your understanding of what you are treating? If I can leave you with one important thing today, it's that I want you to take charge of your treatment in a way where you know what's going on. And what I mean is, a lot of times these people just say, I really don't know what's going on. So at that, what I call a regroup, I always try to end and say, with the couple or the lady or the gentleman or whatever. So in summary, you know, our major issues here are fallopian tube problem, ovulation problem, but I think it's really important to know what you're treating, and that should make sense to you, right? I mean, if you're a financial advisor or you're writing somebody's will or whatever, you want to know, like, what's your investment horizon and what's your income and what's your, you're going to find out that information. This is the same thing. We need to know what we're treating so we can design a plan that works for you. That's not, I mean, and even couples who have similar situations often have different treatments. Does that make sense? Because every couple is different. All right, if you're fertile, you have a ballpark 15 to 18% chance per month. If it's been more than a year, it's 2% or less. Clomid and IUI, I gotta tell you, I always tell the truth. Clomid and IUI is gonna get you about 10% per month. That's really important that you guys know that. So, it varies a little bit. If you have PCOS, your number's going to be higher. This is meant to be, you're going to be 20%. In the injectables and so forth, this slide was from 2010. That's when I made this slide. This is the pregnancy rate in IVF. And it sounds like I'm pushing IVF. I'm not. I just want you to show you a slide that show you how much things have changed in 5 or 6 years.
What's the difference between the injection IUI and then the injection with letrozole?
So I call that a hybrid cycle. So great. So letrozole is just oral medications. If you add injectable medication, I'm not talking Avadril, Falstim, Gonalef, those things, you're going to get a higher pregnancy rate. Here's the problem. Anybody know the problem with injectables?
Multiples.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Multiples. So you have to be very judicious. This space has really shrunk in the United States because of the push away from high-order multiple gestations. This space is, it scares me a lot to do this kind of treatment on my PCOS ladies who won't respond to pills. They won't respond, they're resistant. No, you're giving them medicine, you're hitting them, you're doing all the right things. It's just not enough to push the boulder over the hill and get them going. But you know, those ladies' ovaries are like this, and here's the boulder. And once I get it down here, they just explode. So number one, I tell the husbands here, I'm like, don't even look at your wife once we start treatment. You know, don't, no cheating, no condoms, no nothing. Because this is how you get a litter when things go bad and patients break through. And that is bad. And I have a good, I do not have a temper. But if you break that rule, I'm going to yell at you. Because this is serious business. The point is, it's not wrong. This is a good space for women who have really severe, who have severe DOR and don't want to do IVF. Because they're not at super huge risk for multiples because they have egg health issues. Does that make sense? But there are physicians among us who aren't really doing very much of that. I don't do too terribly much of that.
I have a question on this one too.
Yeah.
If you're responding well to the Clomid, mm-hmm. at what point would you, and you're still not getting pregnant, at what point would you recommend moving on to the
coming up. Got a slide for it. Great question. So I just wanted to brag a little bit about the infertility world in general. These were pregnancy rates in 2010. These are pregnancy rates in Denver, where I was. Look, we went from 58 to the mid-70s in about 5 or 6 years, due most significantly to genetic testing of the embryo. We'll talk about that briefly. This is our oral medicine. This is our follicle. This is our sperm. We concentrate and purify it, get the Navy SEAL guys ready to go, all right? And we put them up here inside the uterus with all the best swimmers, and they can find the egg. Now, in a good world, you've done the HSG, you know the tube's open, you've taken the medicine, you know the sperm is pretty good, you know you've ovulated because you did an ultrasound. You know when you ovulated because you took Ovidril, you're going to ovulate, right? You get the sperm up there. All right? This is a basic oral medication cycle. We talked about injectable medications. Talked about this as well. To your question, the cumulative pregnancy rate per treatment cycle declines the further you go. I really strongly advise against more than six cycles. And I start to move my patients on after three. Because if you aren't pregnant in the first three, just use common sense, folks. If it didn't work in the first three tries, it's not likely to work. Can you do a fourth? Sure, absolutely. Yes, ma'am.
Now, what happens if you get pregnant but miscarry, and like, do you eventually change the protocol?
Why are you asking me hard questions? No, good question. I take it on a case-by-case basis. So miscarriage is a totally different topic, but let me just cover them briefly because they're going to tell me I got to quit talking in a minute. Most miscarriages, the vast majority, occur as a consequence of an abnormal embryo. So that is Mother Nature's biologic safety gate taking care of that pregnancy. And I know that's harsh and it's hard to hear, but that's the doggone truth. I run into the same sort of question, different question, but people come to me and their OBGYN did three Clomid cycles, but no IUIs, but they weren't monitored, they didn't use Ovidril. Like, how do I count that? Is that 1.5 tries? If they tried three, do I count as two? I think you take it on a case-by-case basis. I look at the patient, and I look at what's going on, you know? If the egg health is bothering me, I'm like, we need to move on, we need to get more aggressive. If everything looks great, no cookie-cutter approach. Talking to the couple and figuring out what's right for them is the most important thing. So I didn't really answer your question good because I don't have a great answer for you. I would say I'm ambivalent about that because it doesn't, you know, I might say, okay, we try one or two more. Does that make sense?
Yes.
But it doesn't make me feel better because people say, well, I got pregnant, isn't that good? Well, sort of, but in theory, you got pregnant and your embryo was abnormal, so maybe that's an egg health issue. And it's not always about the egg. Let me make a statement because it sounds like I'm picking on the ladies. 15% of the time it is the sperm, but 85% of the time it's the egg. And that's not anyone's fault. I don't like the software, but that's the way it works. So, all right, so I move my patients on after three, try to start talking about it, visiting about it. If the couple's like, you know, I get couples all the time, and I remember one couple like it was yesterday, said, Dr. Riggs, pulls me aside, he's like, can we just do one more IUI? They were moving into IVF. I'm like, sure you can. They got pregnant. So some people are in that group. But don't let somebody drag you through 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 Clomid cycles, especially without a semen analysis.
Do you think
think they have to be consecutive cycles for IUI? It doesn't matter?
So if you do one, take a month off, go to Turks and Caicos, go back, come back, that's fine. I don't go to Turks and Caicos. I've never been there. It's on my mind because one of my patients is going back for the second time, and I'm just immensely jealous. So we talked about this slide. All right, we talked a lot about multiples. I am very scared about multiples, and you should be too. Twins are 4 times the rate of cerebral palsy. Triplets are 17 times. You need to have that discussion. All right, big risk for twins are in that gonadotropin space that you were asking about. John and Kate plus 8, before they got the divorce, that was gonadotropins. That was not IVF, that was not Clomid, that was injectable medications. Yes?
Is it true that Clomid has ups the chances too?
It is absolutely true, 4 to 8%. So your baseline risk of twins is 1%. Clomid will make it 4 to 8. Pretty low, let me reverse that. I always tell my patients the scary stuff right up front. I could reverse that and say your chance of singletons are 92 to 96. Sounds better than 4 to 8% chance, right? Almost all those with Clomid or Letrozole are twins. I have one set of triplets from Letrozole. It is a miracle, and they're doing fine, but I should be good for my whole career. Like, literally. So, yes?
We're out.
We're done. All right.
Just so they can get, if you guys have any questions, feel free to ask Dr. Riggs. There is another breakout session starting at 11:30, but if you would rather talk with him.